안녕하십니까. 저는 미국 신행정부 출범과 한반도 평화 통일 세미나 MC를 맡은 동아시아 연구원의 최수희입니다. 오늘 본 행사를 위해 이 자리에 참석해 주신 내외빈 분들께 진심으로 감사드립니다. 오늘 이 자리는 미국 신행정부 출범과 한반도 평화 통일이라는 주제로 북핵 문제에 대한 해법과 한반도 평화 통일 방향 등에 대해 국내외 석학 및 관련 전문가들의 견해를 듣기 위해 마련된 자리입니다. 본 회의는 잠시 후 개회식을 시작으로 미국 신행정부 출범과 동아시아라는 주제로 진행되는 제1세션, 북핵 문제 해결 방안과 한반도 평화 통일을 주제로 한 제2세션으로 진행될 예정입니다. 그럼 지금부터 대통령 직속 통일준비위원회가 주최하고 동아시아 연구원이 주관하며 동아일보가 후원하는 미국 시인행정부 출범과 한반도 평화 통일 공개 세미나를 시작하도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 정종욱 대통령 직속 통일준비위원회 빈간 부위원장님의 개회사가 있겠습니다. 모두 큰 박수로 환영해 주십시오.
2016년은 한국에게 남북관계와 대외관계에서 모두 다사다난한 해로 기억될 것 같습니다. 북한은 지난 1월 6일 제4차 핵실험을 시작으로 20발 이상의 탄도미사일을 발사한 데 이어 지난 9월 9일 되는 다섯 번째 핵실험까지 감행했습니다. 그 결과 남북관계는 매우 악화될 수밖에 없었고 남북 간 상호 협력의 상징이었던 개성공단까지 폐쇄되어 남북 간의 교류가 전면 중단되는 상황이 지금까지 계속되고 있습니다. 사드 배치를 둘러싼 한중 관계도 긴장 국면에 접어들었습니다. 사드는 북한의 공격에 대비한 것이지만은 중국 측은 이것이 자신을 겨냥한 미국이 주도하는 미사일 방어망의 일환이라고 주장하면서 사드 배치가 현실화될 경우 한중 간에 심각한 영향이 있을 것이라고 경고하고 있습니다. 중국은 한국 수출의 25%를 차지하는 최대 교역 대상국이며 비핵화를 비롯하여 한반도에서 평화와 통일의 길을 열어가는 여정에 있어 매우 중요한 길잡이 역할을 하고 있습니다. 사드 문제를 넘어 한중 간 전략적 동반자 관계가 더욱 활성화될 수 있도록 하는 것이 한반도 비핵화는 물론 지역의 평화와 안정을 위해 매우 긴요한 일이겠습니다. 미국과 중국에서 지도층 교체가 예정되어 있다는 점도 우리가 주목해야 할 대목입니다. 현재로서는 트럼프 대통령의 한반도 정책을 예측하기가 쉽지가 않습니다. 트럼프는 공직 경험이 전혀 없을 뿐 아니라 그를 보좌할 전문가들도 잘 알려져 있지 않습니다. 그러나 대통령으로서 트럼프의 대한반도 정책에는 적지 않는 변화가 예상되고 있습니다. 대선 기간 중 트럼프는 대통령에 당선되면 한미 자유무역 협정을 파기하고 한국의 방위비 부담을 대폭 늘릴 것이라고 말한 바 있습니다. 2차 대전 이후 자유주의적 국제 질서를 바탕으로 자유와 번영의 세계를 주도해온 미국이 이제 위대한 미국을 외치면서 폐쇄적 고립주의 유혹에 빠져들고 있습니다. 폐쇄적 고립주의와 미국의 위대함은 병존이 불가능합니다. 무엇보다도 중요한 것은 미국의 신행정부가 한미 관계에 큰 변화를 강요해서는 안 된다는 점입니다. 한미동맹은 한국은 물론 미국에게도 필요한 것이며 한국전쟁 이후 지난 63년 동안 동북아 지역의 안보와 평화를 수용하고 번영을 이루는 과정에서 대단히 중요한 역할을 성공적으로 수행해 왔습니다. 한미동맹이 미국의 대외관계에서 가장 성공적인 사례라는 점은 국제사회도 인정을 하고 있습니다. 이런 관점에서 중요한 것은 남북관계나 북핵 문제에 관한 한국과 미국의 새 정부 간의 긴밀한 정책 협의가 빠른 시일 내에 이루어져야 하며 이를 토대로 북핵 문제 해결 등 시급한 현안 문제의 해결을 위해 효과적인 공동의 대응책이 마련되어야 한다는 점입니다. 내년 가을에 개최될 제19차 중국 공산당 전국 대표자 대회에서 구체화될 것으로 보이는 중국 지도부 교체는 이미 지난달 말 열렸던 제18차 6기 중앙위원회 전체 회의에서 사전 조율된 바 있습니다. 중국 공산당으로부터 당의 핵심적 지위를 부여받은 시진핑의 권력은 더욱더 공고화될 것으로 예상되고 있습니다. 적어도 2022년까지 중국을 통치하게 될 정치국 상무위원회는 더 많은 시진핑 주석의 측근들이 진출할 가능성이 높습니다. 중국 대외 정책의 예측에는 많은 불확실성이 따릅니다만 대체로 현재보다 더 적극적이고 민족주의적 성향이 강하게 투영될 것으로 예상되고 있습니다. 북핵 문제 해결의 열쇠를 쥐고 있는 중국의 간절을 이끌어내는 것은 매우 복잡하고 어려운 일입니다. 비핵화보다 한반도의 안정을 더 중시하는 중국은 수십만 명의 탈북 난민이 중국 동북 지방에 유입할 가능성을 경계하고 있습니다. 또한 통일 이후 1500km에 달하는 국경에서 한국의 정치 군사적 우방인 미국과 마주하게 되는 상황도 중국에게는 전략적 부담이 될 것입니다. 따라서 중국은 북한의 체제 붕괴나 리더십 체인지와 같은 사회적 혼란이나 정치적 불안을 유발할 수 있는 상황의 방지에 주력하면서 핵 문제를 점진적으로 해결하려 하고 있습니다. 그러나 북한이 어떠한 대가를 치르더라도 핵을 개발하겠다는 입장을 고수한다면 중국의 선택은 제한적일 수밖에 없습니다. 한국과 중국 간의 협력 또한 이로 인해 제약을 받게 될 것입니다. 저는 적어도 다음 세 가지 문제에 대해 6자회담 참가국들, 특히 한국, 미국, 중국 간의 긴밀한 협의와 합의가 이루어져야 된다고 생각합니다. 첫째, 북한에 대한 제재를 강화해야 합니다. 도발을 지속하는 것보다 핵 개발을 포기하는 것이 자신에게 이득이 된다는 점을 북한 지도부가 깨칠 수 있도록 관련 당사국들이 보다 적극적인 노력을 경주하고 북한을 설득해야 할 것입니다. 제재와 같은 억압적 수단을 통해 북한이 진정한 대화의 길로 나오게 하는 것이 북한 체제 유지와 지역의 안정에 도움이 될 것이라는 사실을 중국 정부에 설명하고 이해시킴으로써 중국을 한반도 비핵화, 평화, 안정의 동반자로 만들어 나가야 할 것입니다. 한국과 중국 그리고 한국과 미국, 중국 간의 2자 혹은 3자 대화가 절실히 필요한 이유이기도 합니다. 둘째, 조속한 시기에 북한의 핵 프로그램을 동결시켜야 합니다. 북한을 이대로 방치한다면 수년 내에 북한은 100개 정도 핵탄두를 보유할 수 있을 것이며 대륙간 탄도미사일을 개발하여 트럼프 대통령의 임기가 끝나기 전에 미국 본토를 공격할 핵 능력을 갖출 수도 있습니다. 한국과 일본도 만일의 사태에 대비하여 새로운 전략적 게임과 시나리오를 작성해야 하는 상황을 맞게 될 것입니다. 셋째, 북한이 핵 포기로 얻게 될 대가에는 북한의 생존에 필수적인 정치 경제적 유인책이 광범위하고 그리고 믿음을 줄 수 있게 포함되어야 할 것입니다. 이와 관련해서 관련 국가들의 동의 없는 일방적인 합의가 추진되거나 이루어져서도 안 될 것입니다. 특히 한국을 배제한 어떠한 합의가 있어서도 안 될 것입니다. 결론적으로 동북아시아의 평화와 번영은 한반도의 비핵화에 달려 있음을 다시 한번 강조드리고 싶습니다. 핵무장한 북한은 한반도뿐 아니라 동북아시아에서 군비 경쟁과 정치 군사적 갈등의 시대를 초래할 것입니다. 오늘 회의의 중요성은 아무리 강조해도 지나침이 없을 것입니다. 미국 등 주변 국가의 권력 구조와 정책 변화가 빠르게 예상되고 있는 상황에서 보다 단호하고 기민한 행동이 요구되는 시점입니다. 그동안 통일준비위원회는 동아시아 연구원의 협조를 얻어 금년 초부터 이 회의를 준비해 왔습니다. 미국, 중국, 일본, 러시아 등 관계 국가들의 저명한 한반도 전문가들이 통준위원회 위원들과 함께 오랫동안 머리를 맞대고 고민하면서 한반도에서 냉전의 오랜 장벽을 걷어내고 새로운 질서를 설계하는 작업을 해왔습니다. 이 회의를 기억하고 주관하고 추진해온 통일준비위원회 외교안보분과위원회 위원님들, 특히 하영선 위원장님과 전재성 간사님, 공동연구에 참여해 주신 외국 전문가와 국내 학자 여러분들께 위원회를 대표하여 진심으로 감사의 말씀을 드립니다. 또한 통준위 위원이면서 이 회의를 주관하는 동아시아 연구원의 이숙종 원장님께도 각별한 감사의 말씀을 드립니다. 여러분들 경청해 주어서 감사합니다. 고맙습니다.
말씀 감사합니다, 부위원장님. 다음은 이숙종 동아시아 연구원 원장님을 모시고 환영사를 듣도록 하겠습니다. 큰 박수로 맞이해 주십시오.
안녕하십니까. 본회의를 주관하고 있는 동아시아 연구원의 이숙종 원장입니다. 먼저 이번 회의를 주관할 수 있게 도와주신 통일준비위원회의 민간부 위원장인 정종욱 선생님께 감사드립니다. 그리고 또 우리 두 번째 세션에서는 통준위 위원과 또 외국 학자들이 연구한 프로젝트의 일환으로서 발표가 됩니다. 그것을 또 주관해 주신 동아시아 연구원의 하영선 이사장님, 또 하영선 이사장님께서는 지금 통준위의 외교분과위원장을 맡고 계십니다. 그래서 아주 좋은 연구가 되었을 거라고 기대하면서 이 세션을 기다리고 있고요. 또 오늘 통일부의 김영석 차관님이 바쁘신데도 참석해 주셔서 감사합니다. 그리고 또 해외에서 잘 알고 있는 동료분들, 그리고 친구분들, 전문가들, 또 국내의 이 분야에 대해서 많은 좋은 연구를 하고 계신 발표자님들 감사드리고, 또 어제 날씨가 안 좋았는데 오늘 비교적 화창한데 이렇게 참석해 주신 여러 일반 참가자분들께 감사드립니다. 다들 조금 그 투표 결과에 대해서 많이들 놀라셨을 것 같아요. 미국 대선에 대해서 뭐 거의 90% 이상 힐러리 클린턴 후보자께서 당선된다고 그렇게 해왔고, 또 이런 TV의 토론 결과를 봐도 여론 결과를 보면은 지지율이 높았고, 그래서 제가 열흘 전에 어떤 세계 싱크탱크 회의에 갔다 왔는데 거기에 있는 모든 세계 전문가들도 당연히 클린턴 후보자가 되는 것을 전제로 해서 회의를 진행했습니다. 그래서 이제 어떻게 보면은 굉장히 좀 이른바 충격적이다 이렇게까지 표현하시는 미디어들도 많은데, 어떻게 보면 지금 그 미국 대선의 결과는 영국의 브렉시트 이하 어떤 기성 정치나 이러한 것에 대해서 여러 가지 그 세계화 이후에 풀지 못하는 여러 가지 문제, 어떤 고용 불안이라든지 아니 이민이나 난민의 증대로 인한 어떤 그런 자기 국가의 정체성의 위기라든지 그러한 것이 반영된 그런 큰 흐름을 반영하고 있다고 생각하고 있습니다. 그래서 이런 포퓰리즘이 영국에 이어 미국, 또 내년에는 또 유럽의 주요 국가에서 선거가 있습니다. 그래서 독일이나 프랑스나, 그래서 좀 포퓰리스트 정당들, 특히 이제 구구 정당들이 좀 많이 선전할 것으로 다들 예측하고 있습니다. 그래서 이러한 것들이 말해주는 것은 뭔가 세계화에 대한 후퇴, 그 말은 어떤 그 리버럴 글로벌 오더, 자유주의적인 국제 질서에 대해서 커다란 도전이 오고 있는 것이 아닌가 생각하고 있습니다. 물론 이제 그 트럼프 당선자께서 캠페인 기간 동안 한국과의 동맹에 관해서, 또 한미 FTA에 대해서, 또는 일본이 우려하고 있는 TPP에 대해서 또 여러 가지 말씀을 했습니다. 그래서 그것 때문에 지금 저희들이 많이 우려를 하고 있는데, 역시 캠페인 기간 동안에 한 말은 그 당선자의 어떤 정치적 스타일상, 또 그것이 반드시 취임 이후 정책으로서 구현화된다는 가능성은 낮기 때문에 막상 인수위가 작동하고 정권이 들어서면 America Great Again, 미국이 다시 위대해지는 것은 대외 정책에서 성공적인 그 미국의 역할을 수행하지 않으면 결코 있을 수가 없습니다. 그래서 그러한 것 때문에 우리가 그렇게 크게 염려하진 않아도 되지 않을까 저는 개인적으로 생각하고 있지만, 아마 우려하는 것은 그분이 아웃사이더고 또 어떤 생각을 갖고 있는지 모르기 때문에 불확실성 때문에 저희가 더 염려하는 것 같습니다. 그래서 이러한 시기에 속히 저희 한국의 입장이 워싱턴 전개에 잘 전달이 돼서 이제 곧 구성된 인수위 또 차기 미국 트럼프 행정부에 한국의 의견이 잘 전달되기를 바람하지 않습니다. 그리고 또 한 가지 반가운 소식은 시카고 카운슬 온 글로벌 어페어즈라고 시카고 소재 그 미국 여론조사를 하는 기관이 있습니다. 그래서 그곳에서 여론조사한 결과를 보면은 되게 이민이나 난민 문제에 있어서는 트럼프 지지자와 민주당이 아주 극렬하게 차이를 보고 있지만 외교 정책에 대해서는 트럼프 지지자들도 상당히 미국의 역할 또 아시아의 동맹에 대한 지지 또 주한민군의 유지에 대해서 상당히 높은 지지율을 보이고 있고 큰 차이가 없습니다. 민주당 지지자들과. 그래서 그 점에서는 우리가 너무 속단하기는 이르지 않을까 생각하고 있습니다. 그래서 오늘 특히 첫 번째 세션에서 또 이렇게 미국에서 참가하신 분들이 많은데 한 분도 발표자는 너무나 힐러리 클린턴이 이길 거라고 생각했기 때문에 발표문도 그렇게 돼 있어서 뭐 본인께서 이제 발표를 지금 당선자에 맞춰서 말씀해 주시겠다고 했습니다. 그래서 오늘 좋은 세션의 발표를 기대하면서 좀 유익한 회의가 되기를 바람하지 않습니다. 다시 한번 와주신 데 대해서 감사드립니다.
감사합니다, 원장님. 다음으로는 당초 홍영표 통일부 장관님의 축사가 예정되어 있었습니다만 오늘 급한 국회 일정으로 인해 안타깝게도 이 자리에 함께 하시지 못하셨습니다. 대신 정중히 사과의 말씀을 드리며 김형석 통일부 차관님께서 축사를 해주시겠습니다. 큰 박수로 맞이해 주십시오.
예, 반갑습니다. 조금 전에 사회자께서도 이제 설명을 드렸습니다만은 이제 통일준비위원회 정부측 부위원장인 이제 통일부 장관이 이제 마땅히 이 자리에 참석을 해야 되고 그리고 또 참석하고자 하는 그 열망이 강했습니다만은 아쉽게도 국회 일정상 참석을 못했습니다. 그래서 제가 차관인 제가 대신 참석을 해서 통일부 장관의 축사를 대독하도록 하겠습니다. 안녕하십니까? 미국의 새로운 행정부 출범을 앞두고 북핵 문제의 해결과 한반도 평화 통일의 길을 논의하는 뜻깊은 회의를 개최해 주신 것을 진심으로 감사드립니다. 국내 외에 한반도의 통일 공감들을 높이기 위해 늘 애쓰시고 계시는 정종욱 부위원장님, 오늘 행사 준비에 함께 해주신 이숙종 원장님을 비롯한 통일준비위원회와 동아시아연구원의 모든 관계자 여러분, 그리고 오늘 세미나에 함께해 주신 모든 참석자 여러분께 진심으로 감사의 말씀을 드립니다. 그동안 박근혜 정부는 한반도의 평화 정착과 평화 통일 과정에서 한미 동맹을 비롯한 국제 협력의 중요성을 강조해 왔습니다. 그런 의미에서 오늘 회의가 평화 통일에 대한 국제적인 공감대를 확대하고 특히 새로운 미 행정부의 출범을 앞둔 미국과의 협조 체제를 유지, 발전시키는 데에 많은 도움이 되기를 바랍니다. 내외 기빈 여러분, 한국과 미국은 1953년 한미 상호 방위 조약의 체결 이래 군사 동맹을 넘어 세계의 보편적 가치를 공유하는 가치 동맹으로 발전해 왔습니다. 제45대 미국 대통령 선거 결과 트럼프 후보의 당선으로 새로운 공화당 정부가 들어서게 된 앞으로도 양국 간의 돈독한 관계는 지속될 것입니다. 특히 한미동맹은 한반도 안정과 평화의 핵심인 만큼 북한 핵 위협에 대처하는 안보 군사동맹은 물론 한반도 평화 통일을 이루어 나가기 위한 협력, 그리고 인권, 평화, 환경 등 인류 보편적 가치들을 지켜 나가기 위해 더욱더 긴밀히 협조해 나갈 것으로 믿습니다. 향후 대한민국 정부는 비핵화를 포함한 북한의 올바른 방향으로의 변화 등 한반도 평화 통일을 위해 미국의 차기 정부와 함께 할 수 있도록 최선을 다할 것입니다. 우리 정부의 통일 비전과 대북 정책에 대한 이해도를 높이기 위해 다양한 채널을 통한 신속하고 긴밀한 협의에 주력하여 조기에 공감대를 형성하고자 합니다. 이를 바탕으로 새로운 미국 행정부와 북한의 비핵화, 인권 개선, 통일 준비 등에서 폭넓게 협력할 수 있는 한미 간 공조의 토대를 구축할 것입니다. 오늘 세미나에서도 새롭게 등장할 트럼프 행정부에 대한 긍정적 기대와 부정적 우려까지 세세한 부분을 짚어주시고 이에 대처하기 위한 우리의 전력과 정책에 대한 고민도 함께 해 주시기를 부탁드립니다. 내외 귀빈 여러분, 한반도 통일은 우리 민족의 오랜 염원이자 국제사회와 함께 이루어내야 할 공동의 과제입니다. 우리가 가야 하고 가고자 하는 통일은 남북한이 하나가 되는 것을 넘어 새로운 한반도로의 도약을 의미합니다. 한반도 통일은 우리 민족에게 큰 혜택을 가져올 뿐 아니라 자유롭게 교류하면서 공동 번영하는 동아시아를 열어가는 밑거름이 될 것이며 나아가 세계 평화에 기여할 것입니다. 특히 동북아시아와 아태 지역의 안정에 국력의 많은 부분을 할애하고 있는 미국에게는 안보적 부담을 경감시키도록 할 것입니다. 또한 그동안 닫혀 있었던 북한이라는 새로운 경제 시장이 열려 미국 경제가 도약하는 기회가 될 수도 있을 것입니다. 이렇게 우리가 꿈꾸는 한반도의 평화 통일은 한민족의 발전을 넘어 미국을 비롯한 주변국에게 풍요를 약속할 수 있는 것이고 그러기에 통일을 이루어가는 과정과 통합 과정 모두 국제사회와 함께하는 것이 너무나도 당연합니다. 특히 대한민국과 미국의 관계는 한반도 안정과 평화의 핵심인 만큼 양국 간의 견고한 동맹에 기초하여 북한이 국제사회의 책임 있는 일원이 되어 함께 번영의 길로 나아가야 한다는 원칙은 계속 유지되어야 합니다. 주미대사를 역임하신 최영진 전 대사께서는 지난달 미국 대선을 앞두고 진행된 한 토론회에서 누가 미국 대통령이 되든 우리 스스로의 비전과 전략을 가지고 정책을 수립해야 한다. 세계 7위의 경제대국인 우리는 남에게 물어보는 외교가 아니라 철학과 전략 있는 외교를 해야 한다고 조언하신 바 있습니다. 오늘 세미나에서 객관적인 현실 분석과 함께 철학과 전략 있는 정책을 개발하는 데에도 의미 있는 제언이 많이 나오기를 바라겠습니다. 다시 한번 오늘 뜻깊은 행사의 개최를 축하드리며 모든 참석자 여러분의 건승을 기원드립니다. 감사합니다.
말씀 감사합니다. 이것으로 개회식을 모두 마치겠습니다. 이어서 바로 제1세션 미국 신행정부 출범과 동아시아를 시작하도록 하겠습니다. 본 세션을 위해 무대가 정리될 때까지 모두 자리에서 잠시만 기다려주시기 바랍니다. 그리고 다시 한번 안내 말씀드립니다. 저희가 시간 관계상 오늘은 질의를 서면으로만 받을 예정이오니 궁금하신 사항이 있으신 분들은 자료집에 포함된 질문지에 질의 내용을 기입하여 진행 요원에게 전달해 주십시오. 감사합니다.
예, 반갑습니다. 이 세션 사회를 맡은 김주현입니다. 국민대학교에 있습니다. 그 오늘 이 귀중한 자리에 우선 첫 번째 세션 사회를 맡게 된 것을 기쁘게 생각하며 또 여러분들과 함께 한 90분 가까이 이야기하게 된 것을 기쁘게 생각합니다. 오늘 세션은 오늘 세미나는 굉장히 타임리하고 시적절하고 또 의미 있는 그런 세미나가 될 걸로 생각합니다. 왜 그러냐면 도널드 트럼프 대통령으로 선정된 이후에 아마도 이 5개국 전문가들이 모여서 하는 세미나는 첫 번째 세미나일 겁니다. 그런 의미에서 여러분들의 많은 궁금증 오늘 풀어줄 수 있는 좋은 시간이 될 줄로 믿습니다. 오늘 참석하신 우리 패널리스트들을 먼저 소개해 드리도록 하겠습니다. 맨 오른쪽에 스테판 헤가드 그 University of California San Diego의 교수님으로 있습니다.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. It's exciting to see so many people here. I think if Hillary had been elected, maybe the audience would be smaller. let me say one other thing. I was asked to write...
You want to stop a little bit and then I can introduce the rest of...
Oh, sure. I thought you were introducing me, please.
Okay. Second panelist is going to be Scott Snyder, a Senior Research Fellow of CFR, Council of Foreign Relations of U.S. And then third discussion is Zhu Peng, the professor of Nanjing University in China. And the fourth one is Kim Jae-chun, a professor of Sogang University. Yeah. Okay, now your turn. Now you can start.
So anyway, I thought I was being introduced. My apologies. So let me tell you one other thing about whether you should be listening to me at all. When I was asked to come to this conference, I was asked to write a one-page summary of what would happen under the new administration. And I think you have that in your book, and it's about Hillary Clinton. So that should tell you something about the depth of the surprise in the United States about Mr. Trump's victory. This was not something that was expected by Democrats. It was not something that was expected by Republicans. So all of us are in a state of a bit of shock about this transpiring. So I want to say three things. I want to say something about the election itself and the way that will affect foreign policy. And then I want to say something about Mr. Trump's foreign policy ideas, which are still quite vague. And then I want to say a few things about the Korean Peninsula and some of the things that come out of his campaign. And in part, extend some assurances to Korea, because I think the departures from past policy will probably be somewhat less than our thought. So first, on the election itself, I want to focus on the election briefly, because it's important for one aspect of US foreign policy, namely its trade policy. And if you followed the election closely, you notice that Mr. Trump's victory was a result of him winning Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Wisconsin. And in those states, what happened was that white working class voters, which had previously split their votes between the Republican and Democratic Party, moved to Trump very dramatically. And the reason that's important is because the ability of the United States to lead on trade issues in a Trump administration is going to be severely affected. And I would say at this juncture, TPP is probably dead. Whether he can reverse his position on it, it will be interesting to see. We've learned that Prime Minister Abe is going to visit New York to see Mr. Trump. And of course, one of the things he's going to be talking about is TPP. So right from the start, trade issues are going to face a new Trump administration, but I think the election makes it difficult for the US to move on that score. Now, I should also say that unlike Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump does not have a deep foreign policy staff, so we don't know what their views on the Korean Peninsula might be. But we do have a very important speech which he gave in Philadelphia in September, which I think outlines some of the core ideas of how he'll approach the Asia Pacific. And what is striking about that speech is its emphasis on the buildup of the American military. This is going to be a foreign policy approach which in its first instance centers to a significant degree on expanding US military spending, which has been constant in nominal dollars, but has actually fallen some under the Obama administration, partly because of the winding down of the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, but partly because spending has been constrained. And if you look at that speech, he talks about a significant expansion of the Navy in particular. And whenever you hear the word Navy in American military policy, of course, it's referring in large part to the Asia Pacific, because that's where those forces would be deployed. A second feature of that speech, which is worth noting, is a particular attention that he put on building up ballistic missile defense capabilities. And again, this is a military point, but I think it's relevant, obviously, for the Korean Peninsula. You're likely to see a Trump administration put emphasis on cooperation between Korea, Japan, and the United States on BMD issues. And so the THAAD deployment is just the beginning of a discussion of a deeper BMD connection in Northeast Asia, as well as in Europe, I should add. Now, there's a contradictory feature to Mr. Trump's foreign policy in that he believes in a very large military, or he says he does, but it's not clear exactly how he would use it. And curiously, he's been quite cautious about foreign interventions. He's on the record as being opposed to the US intervention in Iraq, though he supported it at the time. He's been critical of the Obama administration intervention in Libya. He's willing to work with the Russians on ISIS. I think he is cautious in terms of actually intervening. And so how you put together a large military buildup with caution with respect to actually intervening abroad is something that is puzzling to those who are watching what he said. Now, we do have several hints. Two of his advisors wrote a piece 3 days ago in Foreign Policy that talked about some of his ideas. And those ideas were critical of the pivot to Asia, in part because it wasn't muscular enough. And so, for example, this article criticized the way that the Obama administration had handled Scarborough Shoals, and it even talked about arming Taiwan more aggressively. So we see a large military buildup, caution with respect to intervention, but then on the other hand, a willingness to be somewhat more forward on issues in the Asia Pacific. Now let me say just a few more things that come out of the campaign, and frankly, these are by way of assurance to our allies. Number one, there were casual comments made during the campaign about nuclear weapons, and it's important to recognize that Mr. Trump himself later denied that he had made those comments. And he did in fact make them, but the fact that he denied that he made them means that the U.S. will continue to expect that Japan and South Korea abide by their commitments under the Non-Proliferation Treaty. A Trump administration is not an invitation to create nuclear-armed Japan or South Korea. Second, on the alliances themselves, I think that Trump is a businessman and he likes to portray himself as a bargainer. And the comments he's made about the alliances have to do ultimately with money. And so after the current basing agreement runs out in 2018, you can expect the United States to be bargaining hard with respect to burden sharing on the troops that are deployed here. But I think it's highly unlikely that the U.S. is going to pull forces out of South Korea, given the fact that it's committed to a position of strength in the Asia Pacific. So one thing that South Korea should be thinking about is if it's paying more, what does it want in return? And this may even be an opportunity for South Korea to put its own issues on the table in the alliance. And then finally, let me say a word about CHORUS and say a few things about appointments. During the campaign, Mr. Trump made the incautious statement that he would rip CHORUS up. And of course, he doesn't have the power to do that. That's a treaty in effect, which has been ratified by both houses of Congress. So if the United States can't lead on trade, it's not the case that Mr. Trump is going to be able to reverse the achievement of the bilateral free trade agreement between Korea and the United States. And so finally, before I turn to Scott, let me just emphasize that we really don't know very much. As I said, with the Hillary campaign, we have a strong list of Asia people. We know who they are, we know what they think, and it would have likely been a significant continuity with the past. And it's possible that in a Trump administration, you might see more continuity in Northeast Asia than we might think. But it's going to depend on who gets key appointments. It makes a big difference if John Bolton is the Secretary of State. That would have big implications for Korea compared to, let's say, a more moderate choice. And so until we see who the Secretaries of State, Defense, Treasury, USTR, and the National Security Advisor actually are, it's really difficult to say what's going to happen in the early months of a Trump presidency. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Hegart. And then, Scott, you want to take over?
Yeah. First, I want to just give my thanks to the Tongil Junbi Weonwei, EAI, and Tonga Ilbo for hosting this seminar. This is a topic on which I think we could talk all day, even though we don't really have that much information. From Washington, so I should actually be inherently disqualified from participation in this kind of meeting because the establishment in Washington has gotten the election completely wrong, and the Trump campaign always talks about draining the swamp. And what they mean when they talk about draining the swamp is they want to change the Washington establishment. And so I'm relieved to have a chance to come to Korea and get out of the swamp. I'm going to echo a number of points that Steph has made and maybe elaborate a little bit. First, I think that maybe the best empirical indicator for why the outcome occurred the way that it did is related to the question on surveys asked to Americans about is the country on the right track or the wrong track? And that number has consistently been, since 2008, about 30% of Americans think that the United States is on the right track, 60% think that the U.S. is on the wrong track. And so clearly this election outcome shows dissatisfaction with Washington. This really was a kind of change election. As we look forward to a Trump presidency and a Trump administration, I think that it's inevitable that a lot of people are going to be focusing on personality. Because the campaign has been so lively. So I do think that one of the, issues that people are going to be watching very closely is how does the president manage his personality, especially as president. And I would just note that on election night, it was very interesting to hear his first speech because I think that it actually gave us a glimmer of the fact that he knows the stakes and his worst nightmare, I believe, is that he would fail. So I do believe that he's going to come at this job with a sense of seriousness of purpose. But we also have some big challenges because in his campaign rhetoric, he has been saying things that are outside the mainstream of American politics especially about America's role in the world. And the America First kind of mantra that has been attached to his beliefs, you know, does pose an interesting challenge because it looks like a turn toward isolationism. And, you know, in that context, it looks like it's generated a lot of anxiety among alliance partners. But what I'd like to say on that is that so far, it seems to me that Trump is just about the only person in the Republican Party who really seems to hold those views. He's going to be surrounded by a lot of people who believe that American alliances are a source of strength. And even though I think that he wants to prioritize domestic policy, he's also going to have to grapple with international events. I want to dig in a little bit more about the transition because, you know, we're that's what everybody's focused on. And, you know, I think that it's true that his campaign was a pretty bare-bones campaign, and they hadn't developed a list of advisors or partners to the extent that the Clinton campaign had developed. And so the process is likely to be slower and bumpier, I think, during the transition. First, because there are so few personnel who have been working on the Trump campaign. And second, because it means that whoever comes in and is hired, they haven't actually been working together as part of a campaign staff. And so that's going to mean that there's some real challenges. I think it means that some of the initial appointments actually may not survive as a Trump administration learns what it needs. Other things to watch, I think, are the potential for a gap between Trump's inner political core and the bureaucracy and how they get along with each other. And then also I think that the gap between rhetoric and policy is going to be very interesting. You know, in the campaign, we saw an all-rhetoric, almost policy-free campaign, but the task of governing really requires you to match rhetoric with policy, and so that will be an important issue. And then also I agree with Steph that personnel selection is everything. And until we know who the key cabinet appointments are, I think it's very difficult to predict exactly what a Trump administration foreign policy really is going to look like. I'll also say a few things about East Asia and Korea. First, I think that Prime Minister Abe is doing the right thing next week by going and meeting with President-elect Trump personally. I think that the president-elect needs to know that there are stakeholders in Asia. I think it's unfortunate that South Korea's political crisis seems to be likely to prevent Korea from taking advantage of a similar early opportunity. I also think that the Trump campaign, to the extent that it had developed any thoughts about East Asia, had focused primarily on China. And so the issue of tone and substance in the U.S.-China relationship, I think, is going to be a critical issue to watch, especially because so much of the rhetoric, especially related to trade, seems to point to potential U.S.-China confrontation. And so that'll be very interesting and telling. With regard to Korea, Steph has already mentioned the SMA, the potential for discussions about burden sharing being more contentious. And also, I want to say something about CORUS, because as it came up in the political debate, what struck me is how CORUS really, I think, is different in context and in substance from some of the other trade agreements that have been discussed, and the trade issue as a galvanizing issue in the election in a number of respects. One, CORUS clearly didn't have any relationship to American companies offshoring to Korea. That's not what has happened in the Korea-US trade agreement. In fact, the opposite has occurred as a result of CORUS. Korean investment has come to the United States. And also, even though critics of CORUS have focused on a trade imbalance that is in Korea's favor, they have also failed to take into account the fact that there is a services imbalance that is in the U.S. favor, and frankly is larger than the merchandise trade deficit the U.S. faces. And so these, I think, are two important points that Koreans will want to make in order to differentiate CORUS from the broader discussion of trade in U.S. politics. Then I just want to say on Korea, on North Korea, I do think that one of the aspects of a Trump approach to the world, you know, may be that he, as a businessman, actually has a wider scope for thinking about alternative approaches to problems than the conventional wisdom in Washington. So I think that will be interesting to watch as he grapples with foreign affairs. It also makes it very difficult to predict what is going to happen with regard to how the U.S. Formulates policy toward North Korea. And for that reason, I would suggest that it's probably in North Korea's interest to be cautious, because we don't know what a President Trump would do in response to a North Korean provocation. And then finally, I'll just make a point. This is a policy recommendation that I think would have been relevant to either administration, and that is that, you know, the North Korea issue as a challenge for the region is so complex and so time-intensive that a Trump administration probably does need a senior envoy to manage it, especially because the U.S.-China relationship is so overladen with complex issues. And if the U.S.-China relationship is turning toward confrontation, then there's going to be a need for a mechanism to separate the North Korea issue from the other issues and to prioritize the North Korea issue as an important issue for the United States that is separate from all of these other issues in U.S.-China relations. And so I believe that in addition to the filling out the positions in the bureaucratic structure, that a Trump administration should consider very carefully appointing a senior envoy that can report directly to the president, but who can manage all aspects of the North Korea issue, especially in dialogue with China, as well as South Korea and other nations in the region. I'll stop there.
Thank you, Scott. When 세 번째는 우리 난징 대학교의 주풍 교수님께서 미국의 신행정부 등장 이후에 미중 관계에 대해서 좀 말씀을 해주시겠습니까?
Okay, thanks, Chairperson. Thanks, Professor Han and President Lee, for kind invitation to me. So I'd like to respond on a couple of points from Chinese perspective. Of course, totally on my personal capacity. First of all, I see the Trump rally stunned Chinese, not just the only Americans in the world, because we also got a lot of some sort of polling survey, a lot of predictions from the experts, but they totally fail. So we don't know why. Why such a social science suddenly collapsed, and a lot of our quantitative analysis really go very, very wrongful. So then we couldn't just beefing our truth, and then even the prevention of it's just a dropping down. So then the Chinese questions really go farther. So then what's the wrong with some sort of long-term predictions on Democrat candidates with Hillary Clinton, particularly just a couple of days away from the election day, we see so overwhelming the media coverage definitely just appointed that Hillary Clinton will win the election very easily. So then a new presidency is almost just, how say, safely guaranteed by the Democratic candidates. But unfortunately, we see Trump really just surprisingly just winning out. So how to define this? So a lot of Chinese say it's Americans People's Revolution. No blood, of course, very peaceful. So then I think the Chinese concern just very impressively goes this way. How this Trump's winning election could still cripple over some sort of a political change in the United States. So then that's also some sort of a Chinese concern. Then second concern is, I think if you talk to the Chinese ordinary people, most of them very sympathetic to Trump, because we consider we're also very firmly against American establishment. What's the American establishment? They always take China as enemy. So then we also see some sort of a chunks winning, also we'll shake up the establishment and also could toe down some sort of Americans' proneness in confronting the China, because we don't want that. If the China confronting the US, it's really jeopardizing the China's interests. On the other hand, we consider it's also some sort of Americans' preemptive attack, conspiring to get the Chinese weak. So confrontational relations between Beijing and China has never been some sort of options. But the problem is China's getting bigger. We are getting stronger. So China also would like to stretch around. So then relations with Washington has never been becoming some sort of always tricky and even less manageable. For example, South China Sea issue. But basically we consider our relations should be always going some sort of always a soundtrack, without the some sort of a conflict, without the clash. So then now some sort of a very essential with the assessment of our relations is we could competing, but we should still sticking wrong, some sort of a cooperation. So then the China's second concern is what kind of Trump, the contribution could bring about to relations between US and China. Then our relations will be going more confrontational or less confrontational. I think Trump's campaign rhetoric just has to project very controversial messages. On the one hand, he sounds very positive. For example, Trump once say, what's the leading threat to the United States? It's Islamic terrorism. It's not Russia and China. So it seemed to me he's friendly to Russia. Then there's a lot of rumor Russia also become some sort of a strong backer behind the Trump, Trump's campaign. But the problem is if the US could take Russia as some sort of friend, the logic also could be same. The China also will be taking into account some sort of a non-biggest threat, we say the international force. If the Trump's foreign policy philosophy could just have a disclose that way, of course it's very positive to Chinese. So therefore, we're really very pleasingly looking what kind of a foreign policy we'll be rolling out with the Trump's administration. It will be redirect some sort of a very basic ground strategic thinking and just weakening some sort of such a rivalry with Moscow and Beijing, or Trump will continue to follow up with the established ground strategic thinking and taking China as a leading strategical competitor. So we need an answer. But as I say, the Chinese concern is this. If the Trump's some sort of election could a little bit modify some sort of a well-established American primacy-based ground strategic thinking, that would be good for China. So then I have to tell you very cynically, says a bigger portion of Chinese feel Trump is good. So they think of Trump in a very favorable way. So then the Pew survey also showed just the 1 week ahead from the election day, in the Korea and Japan, only 5% of the respondents say that you will be favor Trump. But China, the portion of favoring the Trump's presidency is 40%. Unbelievable. More than Windsor. So then very quickly, the foreign policy website came up with a piece after Trump's winning, say, the only winner from this year's American presidential election is Chinese. But say it's wrong. China is not a winner. China is just more anxious. What kind of the redirection from American policy, foreign policy, will be expected. But I can't agree with Stephen and Scott Moore. I don't think that Trump's revolution will go in very far with regard to the foreign policy reconfiguration. We don't think that Trump could really bring something with a revolutionary into Americans' minds in the foreign policy context. But the problem is we're still very concerned a couple of the negative, you know, the significance. The Trump just very clearly project in his campaign rhetoric. For example, he say if he reelected, he will take China as a currency manipulator. We consider it's a very intimidating. We consider it's a very stuck prospect for bilateral relations. Then Trump also emphasized he will raise the trade war with China and also pledging to, you know, raise the tariff by the 45% against the most of the flowing of the Chinese exports to the United States. We consider that also will be very, very scary. So then I think for the moment, the leading concern from the Chinese side is not insecurity. Is not in military, is definitely in trade and in financial issues. If Trump very, very quickly keep China locked out over some sort of just Trump laboring of China's bad behavior, currency manipulator, trade with some sort of speculator, then that will be very, very greatly and also significantly affect our trading and financial relations. Particularly, look at today's world economy. It's getting worse. Look at China's economy, it's slowing down. Look at America's economy, it's getting better. So if Trump just leverage a lot on some sort of current, his economic, we say, credential to toughen or harden some sort of such a trading bias and discriminatory policy vis-a-vis China, I think that would be very, very worrisome prospect. Because for Beijing, we also have no way but to fight back. So then I don't think in the coming years, so Trump administration will really worry China about it's some sort of newly, prioritize the security gesture in Asian Pacific, or this government, we're getting tougher over China, over Scarborough Shoal. We truly got very, very worried is what kind of economic and trading prospect will be lying ahead. I think both international relations theory and international history tells us very, very powerfully. If the power relations just getting into very, very disentangled of a geo-economic conflict, then geopolitical, we say, deterioration or high level of a confrontation will follow up soon. So I never believe U.S. and China will easily just cause a lot, rush into the confrontation. But if we just to believe we should cost a lot in geo-economic cooperation for geopolitical we say go, then our relations will be really, really in trouble. So then, it's my first point. My second point, it's very, very easy. I think the China also now is open eye as wide as we can, and looking to Trump's, you know, some sort of foreign policy team build up, and also just trying to tap in what kind of the foreign policy reconfiguration could be expected. But in Beijing so far, I see some sort of a positive mindset is prevailing because we believe economically and financially where by nature is indispensable power. President-elect Donald Trump is a successful business people. He also had a very good investment in China. It seemed to me his investment in China is good, very profitable. So then from this, some sort of a commercial connections, we have no some sort of evidence that Trump will be very ideologically, we say, hawkish or hardlining vis-a-vis China. But the problem in his policy will not be immune from some sort of American's current establishment. So his policy, I consider, is also more continuity than any change. So then China also have to walk very softly and carefully and rethinking what kind of a gambit we can both sides just embrace and what sort of a policy course we can just push on and get on both sides just intertwine as much as we can. But so far, we still keep watchful, and there's no fixed conclusion already. Thanks.
Oh, thank you, Professor Chupong. And we'll hear more about the expected policy changes of new administration in the second round. So the last one is Professor Kim Jae-chan. He will express about the new Korean US relations after new administrations.
그 앞에 분들이 영어로 저 말씀해 주셔도 저도 좀 영어로 발표를 하겠습니다. 양해해 주시기 바랍니다. Thank you PCOP and EAI and also Donghua Daily for organizing this important and very timely venue, and personally I feel very honored to be a part of this important venue. I just flew back from Singapore a few hours ago, and I was thinking about my professor, my favorite Yale professor, Bradford Westerfield. He used to tell me that whatever bad things happen in your life, whatever negative things happen in your life, you should be able to learn. You should know how to turn these negatives into positives. So on my way back, I was thinking very hard to come up with some of the positives that we can take away from the election of Mr. Trump. And so far, I couldn't really come up with any positives. So you guys will have to enlighten me what the positives would be from that we can take away from the election of Mr. Trump. I think American relationship with Russia would improve to a certain extent. That's as far as I can think of. Anyways, I still had the time to stop by my place and change clothes, and particularly my tie from blue to red to go with the flow. At the risk of being redundant with the observations made by previous commentators, I'd like to say a few words about the overall direction of U.S. foreign policy for the new administration, how the U.S. foreign policy will be panning out for the new administration. I think it is inevitable for the U.S. to reduce its presence in the world to a great extent. I think the U.S. will have to withdraw its presence to a certain extent from the Middle East, from Europe, and from Asia. I think that's what the electorate wants. I think the American electorate sent a very strong message to the American politicians that the U.S. will have to come back home. The U.S. will have to retrench. The U.S. will have to reorganize American, you know, national priorities instead of trying to frittering away, you know, trying to resolve these intractable foreign policy problems abroad, you have to come back home and then try more to resolve these difficult problems that we are faced with inside in the United States. I think that is the message that the American electorate has sent to the politicians in 2016 American presidential election. So after this presidential election, I think President-elect Trump will become more confident about his foreign policy direction, if you will. I think he might think that the American electorate has endorsed his isolationist foreign policy posture, his protectionist trade policy. So he might feel a little bit more confident, and he might feel that he has this strong mandate to pursue isolationist foreign policy and protectionist trade policy and try to withdraw security commitments and alliance commitments that the U.S. has made in previous years in Asia and then over the Korean Peninsula. But I do believe that there is a limit to which Mr. Trump can do this, because there is a saying that the U.S. foreign policy is what the president says it is. So I think President Trump will have a lot of leeway in making U.S. foreign policy. But that said, I think President Trump would also have to operate within the framework of checks and balances. And I think checks and balances, that mechanism is still very much intact. I hope that checks and balances mechanism is still intact. Sure, both chambers of the Congress are controlled by the Republican Party. But regardless of partisan identification, I think most of Congress people agree that the U.S. will have to continue this internationalist foreign policy posture, sort of a pro-trade foreign policy. I think media agrees that, also agree that yeah, the U.S. would continue internationalist foreign policy posture as well. And we have this vast foreign policy establishment and think tank of people, you know, academia and think tanks, people who think that the U.S. will have to stay the course in the world affairs instead of trying to withdraw from the world political scene. We'll have to stay the course. So there is this Trumpian consensus, or popular consensus, if you will, that the U.S. will have to withdraw from world affairs, but there is a very, very strong elite consensus, if you will, that the U.S. will have to stay in the course in world affairs. So I don't think President-elect Trump administration's foreign policy would not go to the extreme. But when it comes to trade policy, I think it's a little bit different story, as other commentators has already mentioned. I think Mr. Trump is not an opportunistic protectionist. I think Mr. Trump is what I would call convinced protectionist. His protectionist, tendency goes way back in early 1990s, and his protectionist penchant has been fairly constant and then very strong all throughout these years. And I think the national consensus in the U.S. on pro-trade is relatively weak compared to the consensus on security policy, consensus on international foreign policy. And also, trade policy can become a lot more politically sensitive. So it would not come as a big surprise if Mr. Trump's the trade policy would become very much protectionist. Let me say a few words about how the U.S.-Korea relationship would be shaping up for the next administration. As we all know, the relationship between the two countries has been in good shape. As a matter of fact, the relationship between the two countries has been in excellent shape in recent years. And the two countries have been very reliable partners on and off the Korean Peninsula, cooperating on a number of issues, not just traditional security issues, but also non-traditional security issues. But the election of Mr. Trump will test the durability of the relationship between the two countries in coming years. Some people might think that, well, all these things that Mr. Trump has been saying so far, you know, these are for election purposes. So it's going to be business as usual between the two countries. But I doubt that. I doubt that. I think it's going to be anything but business as usual. It's going to be very, very difficult challenge to both countries. I think as other commentators have already mentioned, the Asia rebalancing strategy is over. As Asia rebalancing strategy, as we know it, is over. You know, TPP is gone, and we all knew that TPP was like the golden jewel of TPP. So without TPP, what do we have got, really? I think Mr. Trump will try very hard to come up with his own version of Asian policy. But in his own version of Asian policy, Mr. Trump might have to become more reliant on alliance partners, as a matter of fact, because there is a limit to which Mr. Trump can project American resources into the region. That's not what the electorate wants. So there's a dilemma here. Mr. Trump wants to withdraw alliance commitments to a certain extent, but the fact is that Mr. Trump will have to rely more on the alliances to pursue his own version of Asian policy. And in his own Asian policy, I think Mr. Trump will be asking more for burden sharing. I mean, you know, the things that Mr. Trump has been saying so far isn't really burden sharing to me. I think it was more of a cost sharing. You'll have to pay like 100% of the costs of stationing U.S. forces in Korea. Well, maybe we can pay more, but the real challenge lies in true meaning of burden sharing. You have to do more. You have to play more roles in containing China, maybe, over South China Sea. I think Mr. Trump can become more blatant toward the Koreans in asking for, you know, expediting security cooperation with Japan without considering domestic political situations in South Korea. So I think it is quite possible for Mr. Trump to ask for South Koreans to contribute more. I mean, direct contribution to American national interests. You know, he's been saying that, well, we are doing a lot to defend your country, but what have you done to us? So you gotta do more. You have to make more direct contributions to the United States to improve, to protect and promote American national interests. You really have to do more to make America great again. So I think that's the challenge that South Koreans will be facing down the road, to become more contributing, not just in terms of financial resources, but also in terms of the roles that we'll have to play. I think Mr. Trump's demands are not going to be that nuanced. That's the impression that I've got so far. He'll be making more blatant demands towards South Koreans. And if we do not really live up to these demands or expectations, I think there is a possibility, although it is a remote possibility, that Mr. Trump might think that, well, hell with the alliance with the South Koreans. Okay, we have the alliance with Japan. And Japan has been doing very well, I mean, historically, in terms of confronting or in terms of containing China all these years. So I think it is possible for the alliance partnership between the two countries, will the importance will dwindle to a certain extent, whereas the American alliance partnership with Japan, the importance could increase. Just a few more words about North Korean nuclear problems. I'm not really sure whether the two countries will see the North Korean nuclear problems eye to eye for the next administration. I think South Korea, I mean, as for deterring North Korean threats, I think South Korea might ask more to Americans to provide more. I mean, you know, to be more explicit in terms of providing deterrence. You know, be more explicit in this ambiguous concept of extended deterrence. You know, that's what we've been asking so far. You know, think about this possibility, redeploying American tactical nuclear weapons to the Korean Peninsula. You know, stationing some of the key American strategic military assets on the Korean Peninsula. But the U.S. has been declining. And I think Trump administration will also probably say, well, the measures that we have for deterrence, they are already enough. So do not even ask that. That's an impossibility. So in which case, I think South Koreans might become more enthusiastic about this idea of developing our nuclear weapons, which in turn could sour the relationship between the two countries even further. In terms of, as for how we could denuclearize North Koreans, I don't know, some people think that, well, Trump administration might weigh in the possibility of launching a preemptive strike, but I think that's an impossibility given the national mood. The national mood is that, well, the U.S. shouldn't be getting entangled in military conflicts abroad. So I think that is not an option. A more possible option, I think, is possible for the Trump administration to become a little bit quicker than we think in terms of negotiating with North Koreans. That's a possibility that we'll have to weigh in. I don't know. I might sound a little bit pessimistic here, but I think the task of academician is to become pessimistic or thinking about all these worst-case scenarios. But for this worst-case scenario not to be turning into reality, I think the role of foreign policy establishment and the role of academicians are very important in terms of sort of pressurizing President-elect Trump and then to steer Mr. Trump into the right direction. I think the role of a foreign policy establishment, the role of academicians and the role of media, so-called elites, the role is very, very important. I'll pause there. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Kim Jae-chun. Now we have about 20 more minutes to our discussion. So before we go to the second round of discussion, I will raise a couple of talking issues, and then you will choose one of those. And 그 미국과 중국 사이에는 많은 그 현안 이슈들이 있습니다. Impending 되고 굉장히 important 이슈들이 많은데 그 중에는 북한의 핵 문제도 있고 그 중국과 일본의 테리토리 문제도 있고 대만 문제도 있고 사우스 차이나 시 문제도 있고 필리핀, 미얀마, 베트남 이런 이슈들이 있습니다. 그래서 미국과 중국 사이에 북한 핵 문제를 푼다는 게 이런 패키지 안에 들어있는 이슈로 생각하는데 그 문제를 maybe Stephen Haggard, you can answer that. Can we single out the nuclear issues of North Korea from those package of the issues? And then that's going to be the first question. And then second one, go to the Schneider. And then in within the new administration, they might be take time to formalize the cabinet and get the principle of foreign policy for the Northeast Asia. So when do you expect that kind of time will come? How long does it take from now on? And then the question goes to the Jupong is, what North Korean issue is the nuclear issues of North Korea might be handled by China as a strategic asset or strategic debt? So you can answer that one. And then what the Professor Kim Jae-chun, you can hear all those comments, and then you can add some more about those issues. Okay, let's go.
Okay. Let me make a couple of comments on U.S.-North Korea policy, but emphasize that these are really my views. I certainly hope they would be the views of an incoming administration, but they may not be. First of all, I think that most analysts of North Korea in the United States take the Byung-jin line very seriously. And by that, I mean that we believe that Kim Jong-un believes that he can pursue nuclear weapons and economic development at the same time. Now, whether that's correct or not, we'll see, but we believe that he thinks he can do that. And what that means is that the likelihood that North Korea will denuclearize is low. I mean, I think that's a view. The second point, however, is that North Korea is becoming a US-China problem. And one thing that we want to do to avoid the drift towards more confrontation with China is to try to separate off North Korea as an issue. And that's why both Scott and I believe that the new administration should think seriously about sending a special envoy to China to try to elevate the status of the North Korean issue between the US and China so that we can at least have a discussion about moving back to negotiations. Now, in general, US policy in the United States towards North Korea at the moment, I think the consensus is that it has to be a two-track policy. And the two-track policy means that the US and our allies will pursue a strengthening of the deterrent and sanctions, but at the same time, there has to be an offer, at least, of going back to some kind of talks. Now, that may not be the six-party talks, it may be two-track talks, but we're not going to get cooperation with China and North Korea unless there's some offer of talks. And so I'm hoping that Mr. Trump acknowledges that fact and that the US and South Korea can cooperate in trying to make an offer to China that if China can bring North Korea back to the talks, that the United States and South Korea will show up, which is our obligation, I think, to do. Even if it's a low likelihood that North Korea will pursue that course. So that's what I'll say on that issue, and I'll leave it.
Okay, sorry.
Okay. I want to start actually by making a couple of comments about Kim Jae-chun's presentation. One, I just want to say that I think the American public continues to support an international role for the United States. And so there's a difference, I think, between where the American public is and the contours of a Trump policy. I'm not sure that the US public necessarily wants to see retrenchment to the degree that is being projected by Trump. But at the same time, the domestic agenda is important. Second observation I'll make is that in some ways, if I were going to analogize where we're headed in US-Korea relations, I think that maybe looking at and comparing this with Bush Nomuhyan could be a comparison, except that this time the unpredictable actor is on the US side. So I do anticipate that there could be some real challenges in coordination, but I also believe that the alliance, the institutional foundations of the alliance will survive. In terms of the timeline for new appointments in a Trump administration, I mean, what we usually see is cabinet level names are made about a month after, 4 to 6 weeks after the election. And then, you know, the transition team has an enormous job because they've got to fill 4,000 positions across the top levels of the US government. And many of those positions require confirmation. And so our transition, every time there's a new administration, has been very intense in terms of the amount of time that it's taken. 8 years ago, the Assistant Secretary for East Asia was not in office, I think, until June or July. And so that means that in the first 6 months, the National Security Council, which is not confirmed by the Congress, bears an incredible responsibility and is under a lot of pressure. And so those are the positions that I think are really critical in the first 6 months, who's in the White House in the National Security Council. But it also means that, frankly, you know, an administration is very vulnerable within the first 6 months to policy being shaped by events. And that's one reason why, you know, we ought to be concerned about the possibility of some kind of North Korean provocation at an early stage. The North Koreans will want to test Trump, but I don't think it's advisable.
Okay, I think it's crystal clear. DPRK is a strategic deficit for Chinese, and a particularly strategic, we say, burden. And then we will see the China-Korean relations. Previous years, we will see some sort of remarkable improvements and a growing, you know, we say, some sort of, we say, hospitality between the two leaders. And then we'll also see trust building is also move on. But side issue, Chile, just throwing bilateral relations back to some sort of back burner. Then we will see our relations with Chile in very bad shape. The strategic relationship almost just, I would say, getting into some sort of, we say, deficit. So then DPRK issue is very sensible, very sensitive, and also it's hard to just disentangle. So it's just lingered for more than decades. So no single issue will be more, we say, in passing and more significant than the DPRK issue if the Beijing and the Seoul could get relations much, much better. So it's the obstacle we needed to remove. It's an obstacle we needed to skip over. But I have to say, my specialty is East Asian security. Very deplorable aspect of regional security issue is where we see the DPRK, some sort of denuclearization standoff truly deepening and lasting. But my observation is clear. It's not China to blame. It's the US to blame. It's a South Korean to blame. Looking back to the 2003 to 2008, when the China, Korea, and the US way join the hands and they move on hand in hand, then we will see we have not just a six-party talk. We also have had some sort of two conclusions of a disablement agreement. But when such a some sort of a consensus broke up, then the standoff now is respectively just getting worse. I think the exit strategy is very clear-cut. We need to rebuild the momentum of a trilateral cooperation. But we say it's always easy to say them dumb. The reason is two things. One is China-US strategic competition is truly tightening up. So then DPRK issue in the Chinese security agenda is going down. South China Sea issue and the East China Sea issue, unfortunately and unpresently, just surpass the DPRK issues in terms of its priority. The second is rebalancing strategy and its sequential impact to the China's national security, added to the Chinese hesitation to be more helpful. To be honest, our policy now is less helpful. So then, who shall be to blame? As I mentioned very honestly, the geopolitical complexity in the region, if always just going very tangled, then the DPRK issue will hijack our bilateral relations persistently. So then we needed to think through a couple of options. Probably, I think Donald Trump's election as a president successfully is a very new gambit because he pledged he would like to visit Pyongyang, not just eating the hamburger with the Kim Jong-un, but if necessary, he can give him a hug. I think it's a wonderful idea. I really hope President Trump takes it very seriously. Look at the Nixon visit to China back to 1997, in 1972, and its tremendous impact to the China's redirection of our policy out of the Cultural Revolution. We needed some sort of historical creature. We needed some sort of historical band, the U.S., along with the China's Korean, to create. So then, yes, I think Stephen and Scott are very leading experts on North Korea's issues. I don't think Beijing will quickly and very easily persuade it. I think Beijing's worry over the DPRK is more through our relations with Washington. Sadly, yes, a lot of our Korean friends believe it's your only way to safeguard yourself. But I have to say it's really, really alienates majority of Chinese. We consider it's a Korean's choice to take the side and tilt into the U.S., pushing away the China. So then we have to live up to such a new reality. So when some sort of North Korea-driven such a geopolitical effects now is stirring up, we need to be realistic. So then I totally favor Trump's, his brevity, and his some sort of a new spirituality. Pilot shooting in Pyongyang, gave Kim Jong-un a hug, did what the President Nixon exactly did in China back to 1972. Maybe there will be a new beginning, a wonderful beginning.
Thank you.
To finger on Scott's observation, maybe to say that the American public is asking like a 100% complete withdrawal from Wall Street is a bit of exaggeration, but the way I observe the changed U.S. From this 2016 presidential election is the country, the national mood of which has become substantially inward-looking. I mean, you got to work with these limited resources, right? And the public is certainly saying that, well, the resources that you have to, instead of expanding those on foreign policy issues, you have to use those resources trying to solve these problems that we have inside. So that public opinion certainly is going to impose, I mean, this is going to set the parameter within which the Trump administration will have to operate. So I think proactive foreign policy making is not possible. I mean, not possible. It's not. It's a possible, but it's a remote possibility for the Trump administration. I worry, and then also that American strategy, policy toward North Korea. I might, I worry a little bit. Listening to Professor Zhupeng's idea toward Mr. Trump's policy toward China. I worry whether it is a possibility for Mr. Trump to outsource the job of denuclearizing North Koreans or deterring North Koreans, that this North Korean problem issue, to Chinese, and because he hinted at the possibility of outsourcing, this job to Chinese. I mean, I don't know whether it is desirable or not, but that's a possibility that we are worrying about.
Okay, thank you. Anyway. We will take four questions. There are many questions. Seats we have it's more than 10. So I will select only two. That is more common and is urgent questions, I think. So I give the question for the American participant, and one goes to the Zhupeng. And the question is like this. For all participants, but I'd rather you guys to answer one of those questions. Do you see policy goals that may be speed up or slow down by the combination of Trump's election and President Park's domestic crisis? So especially strengthening sanctions on DPRK and the Saudi deployment. It has some more comment, but it's two. So you think about that one. And then the one goes to Zhupeng is, what is in Korean, but if I translate, there is like North Korea is keep developing nuclear arms and long-range missile, and then there is opinions that is because China is supporting or at least acquiescence of those issues. So how do you answer that? Okay, who gonna answer?
Okay. One of the big challenges, clearly, is that the U.S. is facing this transition in administrations at the same time that there's a political vacuum here in South Korea. And that is a factor that I think will lead to paralysis and stagnation, but I do not believe that it will lead to a reversal of already completed decisions. The question of implementation, I think that the bureaucracies will continue to move forward until they get some other direction. But it's going to take time before they get new directions.
You have some more?
No, I think okay. That's about right.
Okay. How about you?
Okay, my very brief answer is, I think without the China's support and without China's acquiescence, such as it's never existing, because the nuclear DPRK is an intimidation to China. It will be a big KL for China's northeast parts, and it's also objecting the further integration of economic relationship between the Korea and China. So we see anything but some sort of such a very negative effects. But the problem is, yes, China's policy of DPRK has been always characterized with indecision, because DPRK issue is not just a house between China and Korea, it's also between China and the US. So it's a part of a geopolitical context. So then I see that China is truly hate the Kim Jong-un government, then we consider it's a really, really very detrimental to regional stability and security. But the problem is how much burden China would like to shoulder and get it since then. I see there is always such a hesitation. So then Beijing's mindset is this. So how the meltdown of the standoff of the denuclearization should be through the Washington and so on. So Beijing could be some sort of a power broker, but Beijing is not a real, some sort of, we say, part of the online system. So then such a coordination couldn't just automatically involve China and get China on board and make the China's policy completely lining up with the US and the Korean. So then I see it's a very awkward aspect of the DPRK story. So then new administration, the Trump administration, as I mentioned, probably will bring about a very dramatic, some sort of a gambit. So then most important thing is we need some sort of a parallel of the action vis-a-vis DPRK and the diplomatic engagement to showing some sort of flexibility. So Iranian case also showing us that way. So North Korea's case also maybe the same. I think my colleague also mentioned, for example, outsourcing the North Korea's issue to China. In the past 10 years, I think maybe it's some sort of very interesting part of American's policy of DPRK. But Beijing always dodge. We never say we'll have any ability to taking the outsourcing of the DPRK issue. So then most important thing is how we can build up the policy coordination into the new high. It's a really taste, not for China-Korean relations, but for China-US-Korean relations.
Oh, thank you. Now I'd like to close the first session of discussions, and thank you for the participation of discussions and for all the audiences. Thank you.
수고해 주신 사회자 토론자분들께 다시 한번 감사의 인사드립니다. 이것으로 제1세션을 마치고 약 15분간 휴식 시간을 갖도록 하겠습니다. 로비에 커피 등 다과가 준비되어 있으니 편히 즐기시기 바랍니다. 아울러 이동 시 분실 방지를 위해 통역 리시버는 앉으셨던 자리에 그대로 놓고 이동해 주시면 감사하겠습니다.